As it rose from the beginning of its birth, as we glean from our epistle lessons, and you just heard a reading from Thessalonians, and I'm going to focus, I think, more on Philippians because we started there several weeks ago, and I didn't want to have a really, really long sermon, so I'll focus more on Thessalonians next week. Oftentimes in the past, I have focused my messages on the Old Testament scripture or on the gospel lesson, but I really want to focus on the epistles for this week and next week. Since I have experienced churches in other denominations outside of our Reformed tradition, I noticed a particular denomination's members would make comments about a certain church being like a church in Ephesus, or the church at Corinth, for example. And I would really feel left out of the conversation because I had no clue what they meant. So I thought, throughout my 4 years of seminary training, I had no classes which focused on what the early churches in these various cities were like. We have plenty of classes on redaction, criticism, theologians, language, pastoral care, church conflict and doctrine. But I always felt like some other denominations had more of a handle on basic Bible. So as I was preparing this morning's message, I thought, well, if I'm feeling this left behind, having a seminary degree, maybe some of our members might feel that you don't feel as comfortable thinking about, if I name a specific church, is that a good church model to follow, or is that not a good church model to follow? So when we know someone's talking about a Philippian church or a Thessalonian church, we're talking about a good model to follow. So here we go. If we look at the Apostle Paul, the author of the letter to these churches, we might see, in a sense, several characteristics which are evident. For example, there is Paul the theologian. As he writes to the church in Rome using very logical reasoning, focusing on their need to hear the message of salvation. When he writes to the Corinthians, we see Paul's focus as a troubleshooter, dealing with questions they asked him about problems they were having and problems he discerned through communications with others. When he writes to the Galatians, we sense the need for Paul to be a warrior. His focus is on the fact that some of its members were turning from the true gospel of salvation by grace alone and embracing the gospel of works. His argument for the church in Galatia was that they were turning to a gospel that does not save but condemns. For the last 4 weeks, our epistle lesson came from the book of Philippians. This church was exactly the opposite of the church in Galatia. In writing to the Philippians, Paul was upbeat, joyous, triumphant, and optimistic. What makes his letters to them even more profound is that he is writing to them from his prison cell, not a fancy penthouse hotel. Paul is waiting for his trial, and his future is uncertain. He may even face execution. Paul is therefore not free to go about preaching the gospel and establishing churches as he once did. In spite of these circumstances, Paul is jubilant because he knows the source of all true joy, that in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. When Paul writes to the Philippians, his theme is, to live is Christ. The Philippian church was the first church planted in Europe, and many people were brought to faith by the preaching of the gospel. I might add, not by a social gospel, but by the message of salvation through a relationship with Jesus Christ. It was used as a model for other churches to follow. It was a generous church. Paul indicates in this letter that the Philippians were the only ones to stand behind him financially in his times of need. church committed to support the proclamation of the gospel. Sometimes I think we get a little carried away with disaster relief and hunger relief when we don't focus as much on supporting the message of salvation. In former days, soup kitchens were a means to feed the downtrodden spiritually and physically. Today, many soup kitchens are forbidden to share the message of Christ. Without Christ, the downtrodden will be left unsatisfied because they won't receive the hope that someday down the road, life will be better than their current situation. For example, in my previous congregation, I had a man come to me on a regular basis, needing money for food, transportation, to look for a job, so he said, and all kinds of reasons. My heart of generosity reached out to him week after week after week, and it became year after year, until I realized this need was never going to go away. It was going to be indefinite. And so instead of needing a handout from me, he needed help from the Lord. So instead I focused our time together in prayer. And eventually he admitted to me that he had a drinking problem. That was the turning point for him. That was where he needed to go spiritually. Me handing him money for alcohol was never going to help him. But handing him the gospel was. Handing him a means to get out of the control of the liquor was exactly what he needed. And the next step was to get him to AA, and that was no easy task. It took finding a member of the church who was willing to go with him. Someone he would be accountable to. Otherwise, it was too easy for him to find an excuse to why he would not go. One excuse was that he didn't have a ride, so I gave him a transportation voucher for bus and trains. Then the excuse was that he was too embarrassed to go. He had come to the point where he admitted he was a sinner, but his ego was still a burden that was keeping him in bondage. After a lot of prayer, someone finally offered to go with him from the church. A few months later, I didn't recognize the man who had come to me for help, who hung out at the bus stop in front of the church for years in scruffy clothes, unkempt hair, and downtrodden face. He always called me Reverend, and I recognized his voice when he said hello. What a joy. A new man in new clothes, combed hair, exclaimed to me with exuberance, "I got a job." He made his way out of poverty into success, into the American dream, into all the possibilities of being a contributor to society instead of a drain, and it gave him extreme confidence and pride in himself to overcome an addiction that had a stronghold on him. Now he was in control of his life instead of the liquor being in control of him. For the first time in many, 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 many years, all because of the gospel. I hope no one misunderstands my message this morning. Giving to others is so important. But giving to others with the message of the gospel is more important. That's what made the church at Philippi so successful. Paul wrote Philippians as a small talk and refreshments, but for the sake of unity in the fellowship of believers, a common bond that unites the saints because of their devout faith. a time of getting together with Christ as a unifying factor. To wrap up the outworkings of the church at Philippi is to also mention the proper perspective on unjust suffering, persecutions, and even death. Again, from Paul's letter, words in chapter 1, verse 21, to live is Christ. When this is our perspective, and we now have the right perspective towards life, we will also have the proper perspective toward adversity and even towards death. This is why the apostle can add, and to die is gain. Paul spells out just how this expression should define our perspective. Today, to be referred to a church like the one in Philippi would be a compliment. And this compliment definitely defines this church here at Heidelberg in Hatfield. Generous, joyful, faithful, loving, kind. As a result, as your pastor, I can indeed, like Paul, be optimistic, thankful, and jubilant. Amen.